Hi, and welcome to the New Eat Report for the week of January 8th, 2016. I'm April Shaley of aprilsastrology.com. This is the first New Eat Report of the year, so thank you for joining me today as we talk about what's going on with the planets, all the actors on the stage in the sky that affect us, so these archetypal characters that we have also going on within us. And we have a new moon tomorrow on Saturday at 8:30 p.m. Eastern time at 19 degrees of the sign of Capricorn. Right now, at the time that I'm recording this, it's a dark moon. So dark moons are really good for divination, I Ching, tarot, which we're going to pull a tarot card, of course, today, like we always do every Friday. And the dark moon, we can use the lunar energies as the goddess is waning. And as she does, as she withdraws herself this way, she becomes the dark goddess. And the dark goddess reveals the stars. So the dark goddess reveals Nuit's starry sky, and we get to see what is often obscured by the light. So the dark moon can be a really holy time, and the veil is not there as much. Our consciousness doesn't get in the way as much. Our individual consciousness doesn't get in the way as much of our being able to see that which we can only see in when it goes dark. So it's a sacred time. And of course, in the winter, the light is at its darkest. And here in the Northern Hemisphere where I live, it is winter time. And we're sort of thinking about, perhaps, this is an appropriate season for thinking about what kind of seeds we want to plant and what kinds of things we want to gestate. As the sun continues to grow, and the seasons will change, of course, again, spring always comes on time, and things will come into fruition in the spring. Okay, so this dark moon is not only something that comes into culmination 2 weeks from now when the moon goes full, but also we can think about it's in Capricorn, which has to do with a long-term trajectory and longer-term goals and intentions, and how it is that we want to interface with society and with the larger world around us. And so this can be a time where we do some planning. And of course, we want to not plan so much that we lose spontaneity, and we want to ultimately really just go moment to moment toward what feels aligned. That's our where we're really guided, is moment to moment. But also, it can help to bring it, you know, open up our channel to our higher selves, which is really our self. The higher self and lower self are one, but we don't always experience it this way, which is why I use this term. The higher self has a broader perspective, even perhaps over many lifetimes that are happening consecutively, many different individual perceptions of consciousness. Or I can get into all of this, but let's that could be a whole different, you know, class or webinar or whatever. We could talk about consecutive lives and the higher self, right? Source consciousness. Capricorn is what we manifest in the world. Capricorn is about the world. And Capricorn is ruled by Saturn and asks the question, is it useful? Is this useful to me? Is this belief useful? Is it useful for me to keep doing things this way? Is it useful for me to stay at this job? Is it useful for me to stay in this relationship? Is it useful for me? Where would be the most useful place for me to put my energies? Because being ruled by Saturn's about time and space and about limitations, structures, boundaries, and boundaries of time and space. And so we have this perception that we have limited time. And in the sense that Saturn rules and the kind of truth that Saturn brings to us, and the Capricorn brings to us, that's true. We do have a limited amount of time and space. There's only so much time in the day, as some people are fond of saying, and we can't be multiple selves. We really do need to choose what we're going to prioritize and what we're going to commit to moment to moment. And also as we project into the larger picture of our lives. Then there's Neptune. And Neptune has to do with another truth that runs simultaneously, that doesn't contradict this necessarily, unless we want it to, but is also another broader truth, another layer of truth, and that there all time is now, and there is no time and space, actually, that's never happened. That's an illusion. And that there's unlimited time in the world. So we have both of those truths running at the same time, and throughout 2016, they're going to be making a square. They're going to be challenging each other. And so perhaps in the collective experience, we're going to be, and I think this is happening already, we're going to be challenged to learn how to hold both these truths, and beyond that, multiple layers of truth simultaneously. And know that both things are true. They don't just contradict one another. No money doesn't grow on trees, Saturn would say. Neptune would say, well, in a parallel universe it does. And actually, if you are a master mage, you might be able to conjure that up. So Saturn, how are we going to work together so that we can use imagination and use vibration to break through those limitations, those Saturnian limitations in perception, because it's all about perception, it's all about belief, and jump over or blend over. It's hard for me to find the language. I if you've ever lucid dreamed, you could probably get what I'm trying to get at in my description of like moving from one parallel reality into another. But we have that ability, you guys. It's all about what we believe and really believe. You know, affirmations don't really work because we're trying to contradict what we believe, and it puts us in a position of fighting with ourselves. It's really about loving up what it is that we're believing and acknowledging the way that sometimes our negative beliefs are our system of protection is in place to try to keep us alive and okay. And so it's not an enemy, but, again, this Nui report isn't really intended to be a lesson in how to change beliefs, but that's sort of what we're being invited to do anyway, in the grand scheme of things. As the moon goes full 2 weeks from now, it'll be in Leo, and this has to do with our self-expression and our ability to connect to our heart center. The heart center, again, this is how higher self speaks to us, right through into here. And we kind of have been trained to close this down, or think of it as somehow lesser than strategizing and thinking and logic. And, I've been having a lot of conversations lately about the way that we have been like bullied and, I know that word is overused, but in this case, I would say, yes, out of paying attention to the way that the higher self speaks to us. So higher self speaks to us through our heart center, through our bodies, how we feel. This feels good. This doesn't feel good. This feels exciting. This doesn't feel exciting. And the public school system, this is how we've been, and I've worked in the public school system, so that I'd be no harm toward any teacher, toward any educator, but we're still sort of locked into, for lots of reasons, a really old way of managing our raising children and educating. And I know for myself, I hated sitting at a desk all day. We're sort of bullied into sitting at a desk and looking at somebody who's just talking in front. And I remember what I was doing is, I was sort of hearing some stuff, but, I really wanted to move, and every impulse within me was about movement. And we call this discipline, but it's a discipline toward changing our internal guidance system over into something outside of ourselves and calling that education and discipline, when actually we should be, I think, finding ways to work with what each individual's higher calling is, because that's what we're here to do. And then we spend the rest of our adulthood fighting with ourselves between our higher calling and this sort of download of every other, of society's perspective of what we should be doing. But I remember sitting at my desk and I was like looking at my teacher and like following her aura against the chalkboard. Like that's what I was spending my time doing, and looking out the window and looking at birds and like putting glue in my desk, you know, Elmer's glue, and letting it harden and then using it as like a thing to throw, writing on my hand. I don't know, anything. Drawing pictures, poking somebody, notes later, you know, like this kind of stuff. So this is, you know, you're just, it's just a, it's like a institutionalized distortion of our internal guidance system. And now we're trying to find it by watching videos like this on YouTube and finding teachers and seeking for ourselves when it's really all right here. So again, like I think this Saturn Neptune square is trying to help us regain that sense of connection to our higher selves. And then just that's the larger year-long thing. But today really we have Saturn making a conjunction to Venus, or Venus making a conjunction to Saturn. Venus is the quicker moving planet in Sagittarius, right? Because they're conjunct, so there's, and Venus is about our self-worth. Saturn's about limitation. Saturn's about contrasting experience. So Venus Saturn together isn't always experienced as super cute. Venus Saturn together gets us really aware of what we're committed to. Venus is about what we value. Again, self-worth, right? Value. What we find beautiful, we tend to find beauty in what we value. And it's about the mirror of relationships. And Saturn, again, is about pointing out what's in contrast to what it is that we really desire. And so, again, like I say, that's not really a cute energy. Because what it does is it's trying to, or inviting us to, get clearer, get prioritized in terms of relating, in terms of what we value and where we want to put our limited time and energy, and be more conscious about that. And the less conscious we are, the more hurt Saturn's going to put on us to get conscious, because sometimes we don't pay attention unless we've got a little hurt going on, right? And point out where what we're actually doing and what we're actually feeding may be in contrast with what we're really here to do and why we're incarnate right now. And that can hit in money, that can hit us in relationships. Again, Venus is both, because Venus is about value and beauty and worth. And that can hit us in terms of our own self-value. Like, how am I treating myself? We have an idea, and some people even think this is a virtue. And I know I did at one point, and now I've come to understand that it's really not, to be self-critical. I'm really critical of myself, and we want, like, congratulations for that. That's stupid. That's not a virtue. You are the universe itself, you guys. You are God. If you treat yourself like shit, it is so arrogant. You are insulting the universe. You are insulting the goddess. You are insulting the divine. You are insulting the God. You are not doing the world a favor. Your greatest service, our greatest service, is our joy. And you find, you're not going to find your joy by working hard at things that suck. You find your joy by doing things that feel awesome. And so Venus and Saturn together may show us what does not feel awesome right now. Juno, the asteroid Juno, rules partnerships, is making a conjunction or fused together in Scorpio with Mars right now. partnerships. Mars is about me first. Mars is about how we defend ourselves, how we take action, why we are awake in the morning. It's sort of our desire nature. It's our how we go get things, and it's sort of a me first energy, and it rules how we manage our anger. Juno is about power relationships in relationship, about status, relationship status. Has to do with social status also, which so does Capricorn, with the new moon in Capricorn. So social status and our relationships, that sort of connection is being highlighted right now. Mars with Juno, well, there's a couple connections there. I'm just thinking of another one. But what I was going to say is that Mars with Juno can bring up some arguments. Mars is also square Mercury retrograde right now. So some stuff that we thought we'd put to bed that we kind of really didn't may come up again, especially in relationships. I mean, who else do you argue with? I mean, I argue with me sometimes, but that's because I have a lot of Gemini in my chart. There's a couple of us in here. And that's a relationship, right? So relationships, there may be conflict, especially with the words that we're using right now. Mercury retrograde. You know, we're talking about what happened, you know, you did this, you know, last year, and I never mentioned it, but it really bothered me, you know, like that kind of stuff. So, and you know, there it is. Mars is in Aquarius, the very first degrees, just dipping in there before it goes back into Capricorn again. And Mars is, Mercury's in Aquarius, I hope I said that. Mars is in Scorpio. Two fixed signs. Mars in Scorpio, he's in his home sign, so he's not going to back down right now. He likes being in Scorpio. It's sexual, and it's raw, and it's like, you know, he's psyched. Rules the sexual organs, Scorpio. Has to do with the deep psychology, but it's a fixed sign, which means it doesn't like to change trajectory much. And Aquarius is future-minded and progressive, but still fixed. So we all know people that are like super Aquarians that are like, future-minded and, again, and progressive and, like, you know, politically, but don't change that opinion around that. We don't see other perspectives. So this is where this can get into it. And Mercury retrograde, again, going backward in time and going over stuff that just didn't get hashed out adequately for, you know, whoever the first time around. So we're going through a lot of this kind of stuff right now, you know, and Lilith is also making a square with Pluto at the moment, just making that even more volatile. Lilith's in Libra. She's hanging out over there with across the street, so to speak, in the zodiac from Uranus. She's getting activated. She's getting charged up. She likes Pluto energy because it brings us down to, like, the raw, you know, real, you know, I don't know, nature of things, the real feeling tone of stuff. And so there's that. So we're getting a push for authenticity. We're getting a push for what we're committed to. And then we're getting this new moon. So we're getting an opportunity to decide where we're going to put our energy. So we want to make good choices for ourselves. Again, we do that well by basing it on how we feel, not our strategy about life. That's going to, you strategize, it's Mercury retrograde right now too. When you spend your time strategizing, this is just from a magical perspective too. Everything happens in the world is magical. You know, there's no separation between magic and just mundane world, first of all. Second of all, I forgot what I was going to say. Mercury retrograde. Oh my God. Oh, it'll come back. Mercury retrograde is, you know, we just go over the stuff. Mercury's in Aquarius. Then we're going to pull a card. Okay. So let's do that. All right. Here we go. Ready? Okay, so this is really good card for Mercury retrograde today. It has to do with the Four of Swords. And this is, you know, taking a break, giving it a rest. It's the new moon. It was the dark moon today. It's the new moon. This is a time of repose and rest and, you know, going inward and in meditation. The swords are thoughts. And, you know, what I was going to say about Mercury, too, is and about magic. Magic doesn't just happen inside of a magic circle. It's happening all the time with the vibration that we hold and what we believe. And so we may need to go inward a little bit and pay attention to what we're really thinking about, what we're really doing with our the feeling tone of our energy. And so this is a good, card for meditating and paying attention to our thoughts. What kind of thoughts are going through our mind, especially thoughts about ourselves. Again, we seem to think it's a virtue to beat ourselves up, and so then it sort of elicits pity from other people. Oh no, you're awesome! You know, we sort of want to do that. And that's one way to get it, but it might be better just to you know, why go the roundabout way and, you know, just let ourselves feel okay and pay, you know, give ourselves a little bit of a break. So with that, this report is complete. I am doing a webinar and offering a new special reading. The webinar is called, they're both called The Four Faces of the Feminine. And they're about the asteroids. We talked a little bit about Juno today, but Juno, Vesta, Pallas Athena, and Ceres. And I have a description on my website. You can go to the news section or to the offering section at aprilsastrology.com. And the webinar is all about this. It, you know, just makes it, when we use the asteroids, it gives the feminine a little bit more complexity or acknowledges what's there already and just gives us a better sense of that. It's really exciting. And then the webinar will go into more about that. So the reading is more about you personally. And then, you know, we'll go into your personal chart, which I would love to do. And then the webinar is just helping us learn more about that, really exploring that. So check that out. If you get both, you get a pretty good discount. So might be a nice thing to do as well, get them as a pair. And that option is there on offerings on aprilsastrology.com. So take care. Many blessings. Happy new moon to you.